Ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ για την εξαιρετική παρουσία του case study της Πεσελάς. Παρακαλώ τον κύριο Ρίκ Πιμπινέλα από την Vantuit. Rick, good morning.
Go to 50 gigabits per second and greater. What's going to happen is it's going to be critically important to understand the differences between OM3, OM4, OM5, and signature single mode fiber. This is going to be a technical presentation, and I'm going to describe the differences between these different fiber types. When to use one versus another one, when to use single mode fiber. I get a lot of questions. Should I deploy single mode fiber so that I can future-proof my network or OM5? So these are the kind of questions we're going to address. Also, what you'll find out is that for 50 gig and beyond, you can no longer use copper cabling for many of the applications. So we'll go through all of that. So we'll begin by pointing out that multi-mode fiber will continue to provide three primary benefits over single-mode fiber. And the most important, of course, is cost. VCSELs, vertical cavity surface emitting lasers, which are multi-mode lasers, are surface emitters, meaning that you can make these devices in wafer form. They're typically manufactured on a 100 millimeter wafer. About 100,000 devices are processed on one piece of material wafer, and they can be completely processed, tested. Bad devices are marked with ink. You can burn them in, put them. You can do almost all the processing and testing of these devices in wafer form. At the end, you dice them. For multiple lasers, you dice them in arrays, you mount them into your transceiver, and it's a low-cost operation. Single-mode transceivers are inherently more expensive. I have an image of here. This is a VCSEL. This is a distributed feedback single-mode laser. The difference between single-mode lasers and VCSELs are DFB lasers are edge emitters. All single mode lasers are edge emitters, which means that the light actually comes out of the edge of the device as opposed to coming out of the surface device through this lens area here. Because it comes out from the edge, after you manufacture the laser, you have to then dice it, mount it onto a header, onto some material. Materials are pretty exotic materials because they have to be able to dissipate a lot of heat. Single mode lasers actually dissipate 10 times the amount of energy heat as multi-mode, so they're a lot hotter. You have to dissipate the heat, you have to wire bond them, and then you burn them in and test them. And you get a large fallout, and because you get a large fallout, the cost of these devices become very, very expensive, and that's going to continue to happen. So single mode fiber will continue to be more expensive than multi-mode. The other reason why multi-mode has benefits is in terms of just the size. Because not only the size, but single mode fiber, single mode connectors, when you get scratches on them, those cause reflections on single mode. As you start cleaning connectors and you add scratches, you get reflections. That's measured in return loss. You want a high loss. You don't get many reflections. But those reflections Single mode is a coherent light, which means it interferes with itself. So when it goes through, hits a connector boundary and reflects back, it actually can get back into the laser cavity. It does get back in the laser cavity, and it's phase shifted. So the electric fields actually interact and combine in the destructively interference, and you could actually have very high losses. And the losses can depend, even on putting in a connector, a patch cord, you can get multiple reflections in the patch cord. That's called multipath interference, and you get high losses. So there's a lot of problems with single mode. It's really designed for the long haul, long distance communications. The other reason that multimode is going to be around for a long time is that it will meet all the data rates for the next 20 years or more in the reaches, and that's what we're going to kind of talk about. So I'm going to focus mostly on the differences of multimode fibers and when to use them in the network. Here's when we get a little technical. In order to understand what Ohm-3 is versus Ohm-4, Ohm-5, and what the differences are, that's where we have to get a little technical. So I'm going to get a little deep into that. But what's very interesting also is the power penalties that are important as we move forward into higher data rates. There's also, in order to get these higher data rates, you'll see that people are using what we call parallel optics. Those are multiple fibers. Those of you that may have deployed 40 gig Ethernet, you know they're on MPL connectors. You have four parallel pairs, each carrying 10 gig per pair. Parallel optics is what is the future, and I'm going to show you why. We'll talk a little bit about single mode applications, and then looking forward about 15, 20 years out, what is actually going to be in the field. So I think everyone here is, when you build a link, everyone's usually interested in insertion loss. At 10 gigabit Ethernet, 10 gigabits insertion loss is the only power penalty that you have to be concerned with. It's also the only one that you're in control of. But it turns out there are seven other power penalties that affect the link and limit the link that you're not aware of, or maybe most of you are not aware of. Things like ISI, which is inter-symbol interference, that's actually the largest power penalty in a channel. Modal noise, mode partition noise, relative intensity noise, these are all power penalties that cause noise in the channel and have to be accommodated for. So in the IEEE, when we write a standard, we argue over these numbers, what should they be? So we put in budgets into the standard so that you don't have to worry about them because you have no control over them. What you have, the only thing you have control over is insertion loss. And up until now, insertion loss was critically important. I want to point out that insertion loss is also independent of data rate. It's just optical attenuation. Now look at this chart. You look at 1 gig, 10, 40, 100, 128, and what you see is the reach went from 550 meters down to 85 meters for 125 gig. And if you look at the optical attenuation of just a fiber, the fiber attenuation is going from 2 dB all the way down to 0.3 dB. The loss has gone down to practically nothing. And yet the reach went from 550 meters down to 85 meters. It turns out that what's important now is the inter-symbol interference. And again, you don't have control of it over it directly, but the way you do have some control over it is selecting the type of multimode fiber that you use. I'm going to describe what inter-symbol interference is, and that's where we get technical. So inter-symbol interference is the primary penalty that's going to limit a channel from 50 gigs and beyond. Insertion loss is, I hate to say it, but it's actually not important. As an example, it's important for other reasons. Insertion loss, it's not the attenuation that's going to kill you. It's what happens when you have connectors that are not very well aligned. What happens is it creates another power penalty called modal noise, which is that, so you do increase modal noise if you don't have, high quality, low loss connectors. It's just a different power penalty. So let's talk about inter-symbol interference. When we talk about multimode fiber, what a mode is an optical path. It's nothing more than an optical path. When you have a wave, light is a wave, waves interfere with themselves. And they can only propagate in certain ways. An example would be a guitar string. If you have a guitar string that's constrained on both ends of the guitar, and you pluck the string, that string can only vibrate with a fundamental frequency and all its harmonics. If you tighten up the string, you know, you get a different set of frequencies. Those are modes. And you have modes because you the wave is constrained somehow. It's the exact same thing in fiber. The fiber is a waveguide, and you have light that's propagating, which is a wave. So the light can only propagate in certain ways, so it interferes with itself constructively. And it turns out that in multimode fiber, there are only 380 different modes or paths that the light can take so that constructively interferes with itself as it propagates through the fiber. And what I show here are three examples of three modes. You have what's called low order modes, which propagate close to the fiber core. You could have ones that look like sinusoidal. It's kind of like a guitar string. You even have modes or paths that take corkscrew paths. So what you can see is if light goes straight down the fiber, it's going to get to the end of the fiber quicker than, say, light that's going down, you know, some other more complex path. What's also important to realize is when the light gets emitted from a VCSEL, a laser, it illuminates the core of the fiber, and that light splits and takes all the possible different modes that it can take. So the light isn't carried by one mode, as it is in single mode, but it's carried by hundreds of modes. Okay? So what you have to do in multimode fiber is you grade the refractive index. The refractive index is the optical density of the fiber, and it determines how fast the light propagates. So what you do is you grade it such that in the center of the fiber, in the center of the fiber, you have a high refractive index, high optical density, so the light that's propagating down the center of fiber is actually slowed up. It slows down, whereas light that's propagating towards the cladding sees a lower refractive index and actually travels faster. And the key is, what you try to do is grade the refractive index of the core such that all the modes are equalized. No matter what optical path the light takes, it's going to get to the end of the fiber at the same time. Okay. This is a problem, though. The problem is no one can make a perfect fiber. No fiber is perfect. And because of that, no fiber looks like this. And there's a number that I want to point out because it's very important to understand the differences between the different multimode fiber types. And that's the alpha. The refractive index depends on this alpha number. And what I'm showing, this curve represents alpha, say we'll call it alpha zero. So this is what you shoot for when you make a fiber. But what you get is something that looks like this. It's either it's a little less of a shape or a little bit more. And if it's less than alpha zero, we're going to call that alpha one. And if it's more than alpha zero, we're going to call that alpha two. And these fibers that are made, so what we're saying here is that every fiber will have either alpha 1 or alpha 2. It's not going to have alpha 0 because you can't really get that. The alpha 1 and the alpha 2 actually perform very differently. So if you buy an Ohm-3 fiber, Ohm-4, half of your fibers will work one way and the other half will work a different way. And that's I'll show you why that is. Mm-hmm. So the first, ISI has five contributions in a channel, this intersymbol interference. One of them has to do with the transceiver, so we're not going to talk about that. One of them, which we will talk about, comes from a combination of the fiber and the VCSEL. This is something the industry didn't know till about 9 years ago or so.